اوكي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the All Merciful, the Ever Merciful, and the All Praise and the Blessings be upon all the prophets from Adam عليه السلام to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Peace and the blessings and salutations be upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his household and his companions. Welcome back. We are actually going to continue what we started at the beginning of Ramadan, the series that we have been talking about, the life of the Prophet Muhammad, and also the series of reviving our hearts. And this is the first session that's related to reviving our hearts that's after Ramadan. So Ramadan is over and a lot of people are kind of coming back to be challenged by a lot of things. So the topic of today seems at the first glance that it is not related to reviving our hearts. But when we dig deeper of our topic today, we'll find that this topic is focused more than we think on reviving our own hearts and bringing our connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a closer distance to Him and being more compassionate about our relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and increasing our faith and our ibadah and our iman with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorified be to Him. The topic of today is also related to the current events that's going on in the world and specifically in the US about the social justice and the discrimination or racism, endemic racism that's been widespread among many people. So the topic of today will be slightly touching in that, but from an Islamic point of view. So the title of today is actually taken from a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that خير الناس أنفعهم للناس خير الناس أنفعهم للناس or أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعَهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. The most beneficial or the most people or the most beloved people to Allah are the most beneficial to others. And in other words, the most useful people or the best of people, the best among us is the best to others. How that connected? Because when we talk about reviving our hearts, we're talking about intimate relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're not engaging other people in that. But how can my service to other people, and by the way, when I'm talking about service, I'm not talking about financial support only. That's part of it. I'm not talking about like physical support by helping people physically or knowledge support or all of that. These are part, but it is more comprehensive than we think. So let's go and try to screen the screen and see this in more details. Reviving our hearts. This is going to be, inshallah, every Wednesday now at 7 p.m. Mountain Standard Time, live in Zoom, and also be broadcast live on Facebook as well. The best among us. Who are the best among us? That's actually a statement from the Prophet ﷺ. He said, the best among us are the best people or the best for others. خَيْرُ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعَهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. So that's the title of our topic today. How can, because that's against the idea of selfishness. And one of the components of us humans, sometimes we prefer for ourselves what we don't prefer for others. Or we prefer for ourselves the best. And that's a natural thing. That's a natural thing in many people that they want to have for themselves and their families the best house, the best car, the best what's called the standards of well-being. But they prefer or they favor themselves or their families over others. But Islam balances this. It doesn't ask you not to forget your family and yourself and the needs of yourself and why you want to be a rich person or be a person that you need to support or a person that you need for yourself for the best thing. But also it tells you that you need to be beneficial and self-reflective in the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with so you can benefit other people. And if you reach that level, your heart is more revived to the point that you are one of the best people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses for to be the best people among the people. And actually, that's even logically more making sense. Why? Because something really, I read in a book called Kalila and Dimna. It's really beautiful book, and it's written, it's Arabic literature. The one of the people there said, in one of the pages, he said, there's no goodness, la khayra fil kalami biduni al-amal. There's no goodness in words without actions. And what is the point of writing books without doing them or acting what you preach, as they say it in English? There's no goodness in understanding without faith. There's no goodness in charity without intention. There's no goodness in paying a charity without having the intention that's for the sake of Allah only, not for the sake of showing off or for the sake of people. There's no goodness in money without generosity. There's no goodness, or there's no point in money if you have a lot of money without being generous with what you've been blessed with. There's no goodness in truth without fulfilling promises. You cannot claim I'm truthful without fulfilling your promises and keeping them. There's no goodness in life without health. What is the point of life if you're sick? There's no goodness in safety without happiness. What is the point if you're safe but you're not happy with what with your life? So the topic of today is related mostly by being beneficial to people, the value of that, the virtue of being beneficial to people, and connecting this to the heart and connecting the heart to God or to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can be closer to Allah by serving other people. And how do I see that? To see this as a vessels, I'm using people as vessels to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm using people as vessels for a way for thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings that he has been blessed me with. This is why someone called Ali ibn Abi Talib, one of the companions of the Prophet and the cousin of the Prophet, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, "An-ni'matu wahshiyya." The blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with is wahshiyya, means a wild. It's wild. It's like, you know, wild horses. You cannot get hold of it. قَيِّدُهَا or تَقْيِّدُهَا بِالشُّكْرِ. To tie something wild, like a wild animal that is not used to be running, if you leave it, the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me, let's give an example. So the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me, let's say it's money. I'm being blessed by being rich. So that blessing is like a wild animal. If I didn't tie it by thanking Allah for it, it's going to run away. The barakah, the idea of barakah means the blessings in that wealth. The benefits of that wealth will never be tangible or felt unless you spend out of this. So that's the value of today. The value or the virtue of being beneficial to other people. So let's go and dig more deeper, inshallah, to go deeper in that. So the topic of today, as I said before, is خَيْرُ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. The best among us are those who are the best for others. And the main ideas of today is, before we start, benefits, penal conditions, benefits of that top of that value or that virtue as Muslims, and also non-Muslims, they can see something important that they can relate to, because that's something all humans can relate to in Islam, and Islam can offer you something good in that. Penal conditions, like if you, the losses of that, aid facility that can, how can we do this? How can we do that practice to revive our own hearts? And at the end, we're gonna have some kind of words of wisdom about that topic. So before we start, as I said, I give an example of that. Someone called Al-Mawardi in his book Al-Masakin. The word Masakin means the needy. He said something really beautiful. He said, those who are capable of doing ma'ruf, those who are capable of doing goodness, should not or should hasten to do it, as it is better, because he or she should not be flattered by his or her ability to do goodness. How many times strength are gone? How many times wealth are gone? How many times enthusiasm and activism is gone and you are kind of lazy? Then they are followed by regrets. That's actually being stated by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his famous hadith, when he said, اغتنموا خمسا قبل خمس. Take advantage of five things before five things. One of them is called Shababuka Qabla Hiramak, your youthful time before you get older. Wa Umrika Qabla Mautik, or Hayatika Qabla Mautik, your life before you die. And one of them, wa faragika qabla shughlik, when you are free and you have time to be beneficial to people, take advantage from this before you get busier. Wa faragika qabla shughlik wa malika, or when you are having money before you are actually faqrik, before you are actually getting poor or not in need of money, or you don't have enough money. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also in the Quran, before we study this, whoever takes a sadaqah from me has more privilege on me than I have on him. That's someone called Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, one of the scholars. He said, whenever I give sadaqah, whenever I give charity to people, that person that I'm giving charity to people, to that person, he is more privileged than me. He thinks of that. Why? Because he said that that person, it takes from me money, but the return of that money is so much rewards in a time that I need it the most. What is the value of a phone if you actually don't need it? The value of the phone comes when you need it, when you need it for something to be beneficial for you. What is the value of electricity if I don't need it, if there's a sun? What is the value of water if I'm not hungry, if I'm not thirsty? I mean, so the value of things comes with that. So the value of money, what's the value of money if it's not beneficial for me and other people? So also Allah says in the Quran, أَنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا تُلْقُوا بَأَيْدِيكُمْ لَتَهْلُكَةً, and spend in the way of Allah. Do not throw yourself with your own hands into your destruction, and refrain and do good. Indeed, Allah loves the doers of good. Allah loves those who are beneficial to others. Okay, so the benefits. First thing that we need to learn in that, it's a piece of advice from the Prophet ﷺ that he has given to us. And that piece of advice of the Prophet ﷺ is really beautiful. Let's listen to the Prophet and see what he has to say to us. He said, the most beloved people to Allah are those who are most beneficial to people. The most beloved deed to Allah is to make a Muslim happy, or to make a Muslim happy. And the literal translation, it means, and تدخل السرور على قلب مسلم, to bring happiness, as if happiness is a human being, personification of happiness, and put it in the heart of a Muslim, of someone. And to remove out of that person, and out of the shoulder of the person, the heart of the person, one of his troubles and burdens, or to forgives his debt, or to feed his hunger. That, and then the Prophet said, that I walk with a brother, and in that case, sister as well, I walk with someone regarding a need for that person, to support the person for one of his or her own need, is the Prophet saying, is more beloved to me, that's what the Prophet says, that's the quote, than I seclude or I stay myself in my mosque, meaning his mosque, for a month. And then he says, whoever swallows his anger, then Allah will conceal his fault. Whoever suppresses his rage, even though he could fulfill his anger if he wished, then Allah will secure his heart in the day of resurrection or the day of judgment. Whoever walks with his brother, and in that case his sister, regarding a need until Allah has, until he secures it, like when you go with someone to help them until they are completely are not in need anymore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his footing firm across the bridge on the day when the footings are shaken. That's the first advice. So the first advice is a piece of advice from the Prophet ﷺ. That's the best action I can do. Okay? And that's the best action I can do. And when you're talking about this, when you're having the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what else do you need in life? When you have a love of Allah. Number two is a sin eraser. It erases our sins. And the parable of this, it's really beautiful, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, while a man or a person walking in the street, like let's go, I'm walking to my work, or I'm taking a walk, and found a thorny branch of a tree, found something blocking the way, like when we walk in the park and we'll find one of the branches of the tree on the way of people, and that person takes it, removed it from other people, Guess what, like, I'm just walking, I'm doing nothing. He said, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, continues, Allah thanked him. Allah himself, God himself, thank you for doing something beneficial to other people that someone might stumble and might fall from that thorn. You see how beautiful it is, like the offer and the return. That person, Allah thanked him. And when Allah thanked him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also thank him for his deed and forgive him. It's a sinner, my brothers and sisters. So that value, it's really worth, like when you feel that you're actually doing something beneficial to people, your heart is kind of like happy for this. Even though it's hard. I'm telling you, when we have been talking about reviving our hearts and the practices, it's really difficult to help people when people are not grateful. And we're going to talk about this, inshallah, later on, about this in details. Number three of the benefits, remember that you are a poor person who helps another poor person. What that means? I am rich in my health, but I'm poor in my money. Somebody might be rich in money, but poor in health. Some another person might be poor in technicality, like computers, but really good in construction. A third person might be very good in driving, a driver, but not very good in, for example, in engineering. One person might be a great person in medicine and a doctor or physician, but that person is poor in Islamic knowledge and so on and so forth. So when I give other people from what I'm rich in, that means I'm a poor person, another thing, that I'm given something that I'm privileged with and I'm receiving from other people, something like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا We have split between them مَعِيشَتَهُمْ, the blessing that we have been blessing everyone. اتَّخَذَ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا سِخْرِيَّةً. So each one of them uses each other's to complement each other's. So one of the benefits of being beneficial to people, that I'm complementing my areas of flaws or my areas that I'm not excelled or rich in. You see how that's been working? So we are not looking here in just myself only. And even if you think of yourself only, you have to give. You have to give other people. So that's the value of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created all of us rich in some fields and poor in others. Some of us are rich in health, while others are poor in wealth. While others are rich in wealth, poor in health. Some of us are rich in medicine, while others are poor in engineering, and so on and so forth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in something really beautiful like that, he said, you're putting some of water from your bucket, like let's say I'm drinking water, and I'm sharing my water from my bottle in my brother's or my sister's bucket or bottle, is a type of sadaqah, is a charity. Like, let's say I'm just like having two bottles of water and sharing that bottle of water with the people I'm hanging out with them in the mountains, that's a type of charity. And he said, you are removing stones, like do not belittle any action that you do that's beneficial to other people. Do not belittle that, because that's really beneficial to people and also beneficial for your own heart. Because you feel you are valued. Your heart feels that it's valuable. Your heart feels that it's a heart that's doing its own work. It's a heart that's giving orders and being engaged with other people. That's the value of it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, when I am removing stones, that's in itself is sadaqah. The thorns and bones from people's path, when you're taking out things that are going to be blocking the way of other people, that's a type of sadaqah as well. It's a type of charity. You're guiding a man in a place where there are no guides is sadaqah. You see that these things that we think that's not really beneficial to people. Also, you are one of those of Jannah people. You are one of those who are dwellers, or you are one of those who are the dwellers of Jannah. What that means? It means that when I'm actually engaging with other people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has so much love to me. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, as he said in the Quran, loves the doers of good. And also he hates the doers of evil, al-mufsideen, the transgressors, the people, the corrupt people. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the Quran, in his hadith, one of the hadiths, he said, the people of Jannah will be three kinds of the people or dwellers of paradise. A just successful ruler, a man who shows mercy to his relatives, and a pious believer who has a large family and refrains from begging. Again, a man, a ruler who's just and fair and successful, رجل ذو سلطان مقسط موفق ورجل رحيم, the person who is mercy, showing mercy to others. رجل رحيم رفيق القلب لكل ذي قربة ومسلم, for his relatives and for everyone and for and Muslims, and someone who is in need of money that has a big family but shy. عفيف ذو عيال. Also, one of the benefits that good deeds protect us from afflictions. That's actually, that was something that was common practice among pious people and the practitioners of piety and good people. So when they consider, when I do an act of goodness to other people, that actually I'm taking out an act of affliction, or I'm saving myself and my family from an act of affliction. The Prophet ﷺ said something close to that. He said, every act of kindness is sadaqah. Part of kindness is that you offer your brother a cheerful face, a smile in people, in itself. If I cannot know, like even a smile, I can give a smile as a being a beneficiary to people. Smile can change people's day, can make people's day better. Imagine, like, how can we be beneficial to others even in our facial expressions? That's also one of them. Also, our life is a mirror to hereafter. So what we do in this life is going to be what we are judged for in this hereafter, in the coming hereafter. So what we do in life, my brothers and sisters, is what it's like exactly. I'm sowing and I'm going to reap what I sow. Also, is a sign of true belief and faith. That's also one of the signs of that. The Prophet ﷺ said, may Allah be, the Prophet said, if the final hour comes while you have a plan, a palm cutting in your hands, like have a small tree in your hands, and if it is possible to plant it before the hour comes, you should plant it. What that means? That's a case like it's really perplexing for us at the first glance. What is the value of planting a tree when is the day of judgment is coming and everything around me is being destroyed? What is the value of that? But the Prophet tells you, counter that mentality and tell you, do something good, plant goodness, and don't care about who's going to be beneficial to that. So when I'm helping people, I need to look at the mentality of helping people, that I'm helping people not because they deserve help, but because that's something brings me closer to Allah. That's something that revives my own heart. If we look from a selfish perspective, you're actually benefiting yourself, or I'm benefiting myself in that one. And also that's something that brings me closer and makes Allah loves me. So again, I'm using people as vessels. It is hard. It is really hard. Like I'm telling you personally, myself, it is really difficult to help someone that's really not grateful. And it's even far worse difficult or far more difficult when I'm helping someone that's being hurtful or harmful to me. So you're helping someone, and then as they say in English, I think in Arabic, they're biting the hands that offers them food. It is really difficult to be beneficial. It's really difficult to be beneficial to a community that's burning or demanding, or a community that's not grateful, or people that are not grateful, or someone is not grateful. But we need to change that mentality of looking at people that are beneficiaries of that, because we are looking from a perspective that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm doing a transaction of Allah, with Allah. So the benefits that are coming from Allah. And he's the one that tells us that this life is a challenge, and part of life's challenges to help people that do want you or do want to express their gratitude to that. And what's the value of gratitude in life? There's no value in praise in life as long as the praise, the most important praise for us, is the praise in hereafter or with our Creator. So let's go to the penal conditions and see like how much we lose if we are by ourselves, or we kind of like cast out everyone from ourselves. So before we go to that, I want to discuss like the final benefit, and that's a really beautiful parable here. So the Prophet ﷺ said, the example of the believer is, and he gave the example of that, is like a palm tree. And he said, when you befriend a believer, he will be beneficial to you. And when you ask him or her for advice, they give you the best advice. And when you sit with them, or you have in a company, or you're sitting with them in a conversation, you will get benefited in them. And all of his actions or all of his deeds or her deeds are beneficial, as the palm tree is beneficial. So the palm tree, you can use the trunk for having a ceiling, and the Arabs used to see that as a ceiling or a roof. You can use the palm branches also as a roof. You can use the dates. You can use everything in the palm tree. So everything in it is beneficial. The same thing, the example of that is the believer. So if I'm sitting with someone in a bar, and if I'm sitting with someone in a mosque, and that person is a believer, that person is partying in person, what benefits are these I'm getting in that person, and what benefits I'm getting in that person? That's how it goes. Also, the last thing, it's a sign of true belief. One of the beautiful things of being beneficial to people is a sign from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I am a believer. And to be a believer is not something simple. People can be Muslims, but they cannot be believers. Not all Muslims are believers, by the way. And that's a statement from the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hujurat, قَالَتِ الْأَعْرَابُ, the Arab or the nomadic people say that the amanna, we believed. قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا, the Allah said to the Prophet, tell them, O Muhammad, you haven't believed yet. بَلْ قُلُوا أَسْلَمْنَا, say that you submitted or you became a Muslim. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ, and the iman hasn't come yet to your hearts. So when I'm helping people, I'm achieving a state. My connection to Allah is called the state of belief and true belief. And when I'm reaching that state, it's a state of a belief deep rooted or comes to the heart. And when the heart reaches that or receives that belief, the heart becomes more revived and more revitalized, as if we're bringing life to that heart. Penal conditions, one of them is the loss and defeat. Loss and defeat, what that means? Loss and defeat, when I lose my compassion and I'm losing, taking advantage of being excellent, take advantage of my assets. Like every one of us, as I said before, having an asset. My asset is, for example, reading. My assets can be writing. My assets can write formal letters. My assets can be engineering. My asset can be computers. My asset can be Quran. My asset can be knowledge. My asset can be language or Arabic. Or my asset can be anything. If I'm ignoring these assets that I've been blessed with, that means I'm ignoring thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How come I say Alhamdulillah or praise to Allah for what He has blessed me with without taking that? This is why the Prophet ﷺ, when he gives an example of people, when they die, all of their actions are cut off, except one of them, sadaqatun jariyah, a continuous sadaqah, like helping in a masjid with a light, for example, continuous sadaqah. And by the way, the word sadaqah it's not narrowed to the money only. Sadaqah can be also a smile. As the Prophet ﷺ said, sadaqah can be taking a thorn out of the way of people. Sadaqah can be cleaning the parking lot of a masjid, for example, or helping my neighbor to mow their backyard, or smiling in the streets while I'm walking with someone. or being good to people, or like just saying something good, or helping someone in advice, all of this can be sadaqah. Continuous sadaqah that makes a difference after my death, that's something that I get benefited from even after my death. Number two is ilmun yuntafa'u bih, a knowledge that's been beneficial to people. What is the value of memorizing books and studying for hours if I don't get this out? What is the value of keeping the science for myself? What is the value of that? People think that when they study in the school and they go to school so they can work and get money. So they burn their lives to get money, but they forget that they can do with this skill that they have been obtaining or piling up over years to other people. This is why being active in nonprofit organizations, in charitable organization, in mosque, in hospitals, in any organization, it is a requirement by Islamic understanding, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's a way to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has blessed me with. Two, carry with someone in the street, or to help someone that needs to cross the street, or carry someone to carry something in their car while I'm walking the street is a type of sadaqah. You see, it's easy. It's easy to give a lot of charity here, and it's not really difficult to give that much a lot of charity. Losing this, it's a defeat, including the mercy. The Prophet ﷺ, one time he was, one of the sadaqah, by the way, is be nice to my wife, be nice to my husband, giving, working hard to give food for my family. That's a type of sadaqah. That's time of being beneficial. Well, as the Prophet ﷺ said, وَبْدَعْ بِمَنْ تَعُولِ, start with the one that you are responsible for. So the Prophet ﷺ, one time, he was playing with his grandson, and he was kissing him and hugging him and playing with him and cuddling with him. So someone called Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, one of the companions of the Prophet, he said, Wallahi ya Rasulullah, I swear to Allah that I have 10 kids. I've never kissed one of them. I've never shown a mercy to one of them. The Prophet got really mad and angry and told him, Man la yirham, la yirham. Whoever doesn't show mercy will never be shown mercy. So giving this out now, my brothers and sisters, giving out the privileges that we have, it's something that will be paid back off, paid back to us. And paid back by whom? By the Creator. And the most generous, the one who describes himself as the most generous. Imagine someone that was being generous, planning to do that. And wallahi al-mathal al-a'la. That's number one. Number two, it's a loss of blessings. As we said, like as Ali ibn Abi Talib said, blessing is a wild animal. Tie them by thanks and being grateful. How? By using them to benefit others. Number three of the losses is do not be one of those who are one of those three deviants. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us an example of three people who are deviated from the right path, and he gave them these three people examples, or three people that they are an example for us to be avoid, or to avoid that example. Let's go and see. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a man possessed a well of water. Someone has or owns a well of water on a way, and he withheld it from the travelers. A man is privileged by a well of water, and he withheld it from the travelers. Number two, a man who gives a pledge of allegiance to a Muslim ruler and gives it only for worldly gains. Someone that supports a leader just simply to get a position, or that leader ruler helps him. If the ruler gives him what he wants, he remains obedient to him. Otherwise, he doesn't abide to that. Number three, a man bargains with another man bargains with them and tells them, I swear to God that I bought this, or that was offered to me with that price, while he is a liar. So I need to take the first example. Someone who possessed something, or someone owns something and doesn't give out some of it. And we have the example of the three kids of the three children of a righteous man who wanted to deprive the needy from the fruits or their sadaqah in their gardens until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala burns the garden. And that's beautiful story was mentioned in Surah Al-Qalam. Number four of losses, imagine that we said Allah loves us, one of the benefits. One of the losses is Allah rebukes us. Look how we see that. Reorienting, reforming our thoughts of being beneficial, of being active, or active engagement, or activism, or civic engagement in the society really needed in our Muslim community and can be beneficial for non-Muslim people to look at how Islam can offer them in that. Being driven and being active from our faith by doing a food drive or helping people who are in need, or regardless if they are grateful or not, it's not a big deal here. That's not the biggest thing that we're looking for. Are we helping people to say thank you? If you are doing this, you are on the wrong path. If you are doing actions to help people to just say thank you, we're getting what we need in our life and we're losing more benefits in the hereafter. So that's a way that we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why I always try to train myself. As I said, that's a practice. Train myself at the time of frustration, at the time of being burned, that's not for people. People are the vessels I'm using to become closer to Allah. People are the vessels that I'm using to revitalize and revive my own heart. And probably that might be something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives me for the sins that I've done in my life. Forgives me for my flaws. Forgives me for my shortcomings. Forgives me for everything I'm challenging with. Probably. And that's, look at the example. A man, a woman. And she was described, a woman that was cleaning the masjid of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. She used to pick the dirt and stuff in the masjid. The masjid was not paved. It was not ceramic, tile, or nothing. It was just like hasa, like small rocks, small stones. And she keeps cleaning the masjid. That woman passed away one day and that was a night. So the people after the Aisha time, so the people prepared her and then they took her to the cemetery and then they buried her. So the Prophet next day, he asked about her. He said, where's the woman that uses to clean the masjid? They said she died and we didn't want to bother you, the Messenger of Allah, by coming to pray janazah on her. He said, Ala akhbartumuni? Why didn't he tell me? He was super sad that he didn't pray the funeral prayer on her. The Messenger of Allah himself wants to pray for that woman. Regardless, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's no matter how flaw you have, or no matter how shortcomings you have done, or no matter how many sins you have done, never give hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second you give hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the second he leaves you alone. But never ever give hope, never ever try to come closer to him by any good action that you do. And pray to him, tell him, oh Allah, I'm struggling with prayers. Or oh Allah, I'm struggling with drinking. Or oh Allah, I'm struggling with my family. Or oh Allah, I'm struggling with all of this. But I'm trying to be helpful, be beneficial to people, hoping that this will help me to overcome this. Or maybe one day this will help me. The Prophet ﷺ went to her cemetery, her tomb, and prayed for her there. And he said, this is a woman from the people of Jannah. Imagine. Also in another example, he says, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, there was a man got into Jannah for a dog that man drank, who was super thirsty in the flat, in the dark, in the midst of the desert. And he found a well. So he went down the well. He filled his, azakumullah, may Allah bless you, with his shoes with water and drank from it. He was super thirsty. And then after he really quenched his thirst or become not thirsty anymore, he found the dog like panting and the dog like was super thirsty. He said, probably this dog is feeling what I used to feel before I drank. So he went back to the well, got filled it with water, make this dog drink from his shoes and until this dog feels fine, and then he went continued on. Allah subhanahu, the Prophet said, that person enter Jannah for that action. When I'm saying being beneficial, it doesn't mean that I'm only beneficial to people. I'm beneficial to the environment. I'm beneficial to dogs, animals, regardless what this animal is. Especially, and more rewards we get by more that thing or that person is in need. Like if I'm having a pet, a cat, and I'm giving food to that cat, that's great. But if I'm helping a cat that's a stray cat that's dying, that's more beneficial to you and for the cat. Why? Because that cat is in more desperate need for that. The same thing goes with people. The same thing goes with everyone. When I'm saying that Allah rebukes us in the day of judgment or on the day of judgment, and that's one of the losses, listen to this. Listen to that saying. That will explain to you. And this saying, it was mentioned in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, in the day of judgment, Allah exalted, the exalted and the glorious would say on the day of judgment, O son of Adam, I was sick. Allah was saying here in the day of judgment, I was sick, but he did not visit me. So the person would be shocked. How would the person would say, the people would say, or the person would say, oh my Lord, how could I visit you, whereas you are the Lord of the world? How can I visit you? And how can you become sick? So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond and say, didn't you know that such and such servant of mine was sick and he didn't visit him? Visiting the people who are sick in hospitals or visiting the people who are struggling with some sickness. Allah will say, put himself in that person, that when you visit that person who's sick, as if you visit Allah. When you help that person that was in need, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm helping Allah. And actually he doesn't need any help, but he gives us the opportunity, one of the blessings of Allah, that he gives us the opportunity to thank him by giving some of what he originally blessed us with. That's one of these. Like, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, Ibn Adam, he said, O son of Adam, I asked food from you, but he didn't feed me. He said, my Lord, how could I feed you while you are the Lord of the world? He said, didn't you know that such and such servant of mine asked food from you, but he didn't feed him or her? Or were you not aware that if you have fed him, you would have fed him by my side? That's what Allah said. And also Allah would say, O son of Adam, I asked drink from you, but you didn't provide me. He would say, how can I provide you with drinks? And you are the Lord of the world. Allah will respond and say, didn't you know that such servant and servant asked you for drink and you didn't provide him or her? Haven't you know if you provided him with drink, you would have found him near me? Look at that beautiful thing. So saying all of this, that doesn't mean that this practice is easy, okay? I'm not saying that this practice of being beneficial to people, especially when I'm burned, especially when I'm struggling, especially when I need help myself, especially if I'm struggling personally or family-wise or publicly or financially and so on and so forth. Even if I'm struggling with this, it is really difficult to help other people. And also, as I said before, when people are not grateful or are not thankful for this. So the best way to get this practice more intact is to take it step at a time and to be consistent and not to look for praise. So number one in aid facilities is visit those who are challenges, who are having challenges, who are in challenges, whether financial or especially those who are in bala or darra, the people who are sick. That helps us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing he has given to us and to be beneficial for them. Number two, we need to acknowledge the blessings through thanking Allah for it. And thanking Allah is through using that blessing to benefit other people. Number three, get the arrogance out of your heart. Do not ever come in the or be crippled by the trap that someone called Qarun was one of the people of the Prophet Moses alayhi salam. He said he was super rich. He said, I've obtained that wealth from my knowledge. قال إنما أوتيته على علم عندي. And then what happened to that person as a response to his arrogance? فخسفنا به وبداره الأرض. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, we swallowed, we made the earth, swallowed him and his wealth. So that wealth is useful, is useless if it's been covered or coated by arrogance. Abdullah ibn Salam was seen carrying a bundle. One of the righteous people and followers, he said, he was seen carrying a bundle. He was a rich person. He doesn't need money. He was carrying a bundle of logs. And when the people saw him, he said, they asked him, why did you do that? He said, you don't have to carry logs and sell them in the street and humiliate yourself. He said, I don't have to work, but I want to counter my arrogance. He felt arrogance in himself, thinking that the people who are working with their hands, like the workers or laborers, think that he's better than them, so he went to work them. So if one day, if you think the people who cleans bathrooms and stations and people who are working drivers or people cleaning streets, if you feel some arrogance with that, spend the day doing it. One day go to a masjid and clean its bathroom. And actually that's really beneficial. That's really counter. It's like exactly your arrogance is like burning and it's fire. And then you're putting water in the fire, relaxing and being humble. So be humble when the dust has been humiliated. And this is why Khalid Abu Shadi said, when the dust has been humiliated and then used to be a cleaner. So for the faces in Tayammum. So he's given an example. He said like when the dust has been in the floor and we walk in it, it has become for us something that we put in our face to pray if we don't have water. Dust to the faces, the toppest part of the human body. That's number three. Number four, do not hesitate to stop wrong and support those who need support. And that's related a little bit to what's happening now. So for example, the incidents of George Floyd, that's completely explicit wrong. Somebody taking advantage of his position as an officer to chalk someone to death while there's no need for it. That person is not carrying a gun. That person is not doing anything. And you are four officers and doing that, that's completely ignorant and completely wrong and completely stupid. Not being silent to this, being beneficial to people by at least speaking out about this. And not, this is why one of the companions of the Prophet, he said and told him, Ya Rasulallah, if I support my people, the people of my clan, the people of my tribe, the people of my color, the people of my race, the people of my religion, if I support them and I know that they are wrong, they are transgressors, is that hamiyah, is that chauvinism, is that trivialism? The Prophet said, yes, that's ignorant trivialism and that's a part of ignorance. You will see a video from me about four types of ignorance that the Quran discusses, but there's no need to go deeper in that, inshallah, because our time. Number six, identify your assets and use them. Otherwise, they will get trusty and useless. As I said before, there's no value in knowledge if you don't spread it. There's no value of health if you don't help people. There's no value of wealth if you don't give share of it to other people. Number seven, be self-aware of your surroundings and see what people are missing around you and help them with what they need, not what you want to give to them. And when you give something out, do not look at the people as you're giving a human being. Look that you are saving in your saving account with Allah in the day of judgment when you come and meet him. And that's a good deed that you are going to be accountable to. And that's, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most beloved action that you can do. Look to people as vessels to Allah's pleasure, not the opposite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the vessel. Look at the people as the vessel, the ship that takes you from one place or from the sea to the shore. That will make it easier for you, especially when you are frustrated. Number nine, remember it is the right thing to do. You might not be able to do it later. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, probably you now have the courage, or now you have the wealth, or now you have the health, or now you have the knowledge, or now you have the enthusiasm. So this is why as humans, we are asked about our life twice. One of them about our life in general, we will be judged according to what we do in our life in general. And one of them is about our youthful time when we are strong and we have the power, and why we are not exerting more efforts when we are strong. what we're waiting for. Are we waiting until we die, or are we waiting until we get tired? So last not least, the Messenger of Allah saying for one of you to go early to gather fireworks and carry it on his back so that he can give charity from it and be free from need from people. That's also my words for the people who are running after any resource that they can get money from, abusing the system. That's wrong in itself, because the Prophet told us to work and be self-dignified person, self-proud of myself, is much better than asking people to money and some of them give me and some of them do not give me. So last not least, and we end up with this, the Prophet ﷺ said, no one of you becomes a true believer until he or she likes for his or her brother and sister what he or she likes for him or herself. No one will be getting that statement, being a true believer, until that person loves for other people what they love for themselves, which is under the compassion. I love for myself the freedom, I love it for everyone else. I love for myself to be stable, I love for everyone else. I love for myself to be to have a good life, as the well-being, I love for everyone else. Nobody is considered a true believer until they love for others what they love for themselves. That's not my statement. That's the statement of the Messenger of Allah. That's the statement of the one that never says something out of his mind. He said it for a purpose, to teach us a lesson. Let's learn that lesson and let's learn what can be done from this. Lastly, not least, to end up, inshallah, the discussion today, to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and connect or revitalize my heart, I need to be someone that's active in my community, active in my society, even though they're giving me a hard time to be active. This is why I said one time, trying to be active in the Muslim community can be one of the most burning and challenging and daunting thing, but also it is the most beneficial thing for you and for others, and it is the most rewarding thing for you and for others. And Linda, end up our conversation today, because we took more than we thought we planned. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Muslim is a brother of another Muslim, and the same thing, the Muslim is a sister of another Muslim. So he or she should neither oppress him or her, nor hand him or her over an oppressor, and whoever fulfilled the needs of his or her brother, Allah will fulfill his needs. Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah, we'll end up now. Let's come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and revitalize our hearts through being beneficial to people. And remember, the most beloved to Allah among us, or the best of us, are the most beneficial to people. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.